Okay, we're now going to start. So, at last, finally, we can now start. So, ladies and gentlemen, this is a historic event in the history of the university, and we are very happy that you are here. Now, let us have the processional. Let us welcome the inaugural class for 2016 up to 2015 to 2017. Faculty and administrators led by the founding dean, Dr. Mendoza. The alumni guests from Awesna and Isnac. Let us welcome our platform party. Let us now have the opening prayer. It will be led by Dr. Winifred Dupayes, the Vice President for Student Services.
Shall we bow our heads? Merciful Savior and kind, loving Heavenly Father, thank you very much, O God, for Thou hast been so good to each one of us. You have guided us and you have protected us in all our troubles. You have blessed each one of us, O God, with good health and strength. And you have showered us with a protection coming from different places in the Philippines and other parts of the world, that we are gathered together to celebrate your goodness because you have been so good to Adventist University of the Philippines. O God, you are fulfilling all our dreams. This dream of having a medical college here has been realized, O God, through your aid and through your help. Though we are facing a lot of challenges, but yet we fully believe that you are there ready to help and to aid each one of us, so that at least, O God, this College of Medicine will continue to train young people to become physicians as they face the world of work and become a blessing to other people, extending their lives through your aid. As we celebrate your goodness today through our program, may the continued blessing be in each one of us, and help us, O loving Father, that all our programs will give glory to your divine name. Thank you for your love and care. Thank you for hearing and singing our prayer. In the Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
Please remain standing for the national anthem and the AUP school song.
of the AUP. Shine on forever, and every day we'll live for thee. Shine on forever, and loyal we will be to thee. Shine on forever, and this our song shall be.
Thank you. Let us now have Dr. Miriam Nabarte, the Vice President for Academics, to give the welcome remarks.
Good morning. To all our guests who have momentarily left their heavy responsibilities to grace this very important occasion, welcome to the AUP College of Medicine inauguration and white coat ceremony. May I request our special guests to kindly stand as I mention your names so that you may be recognized. From the General Conference of the Seventh-day Adventist Church, Dr. Lisa Birdsley Hardy, the Director of Education, and husband, Dr. Frank Hardy, thank you. Dr. Peter Landless, Director of Health Ministries Department. From Loma Linda University, Dr. Roger Hadley, Dean of the College of Medicine. Our valued alumni and supporters from Western North America, or WESNA, headed by the President, Dr. Elmer Bangloy, and wife, Mrs. Lori Bangloy, Dr. and Mrs. Alfonso Miguel, Mrs. Minnie Tamayo, Dr. Alberto Baguenguito, Dr. and Mrs. Edmund Baguenguito, Dr. Charles David, Mrs. Annalie Madigan, Miss Meldy Ward, Mrs. Lita Laoyan, Miss Fe Asuncion, Dr. and Mrs. Seraphine Garcia, Drs. Wilson and Mariclem Lau. There. Alumni from the Eastern North American Chapter, or ISNAC, headed by the President, Dr. Sal Corquines, Dr. Elmalu Roda, Mrs. Jemema Perez, there, Ms. Lois Quines, from Canada, Engineer Ezekiel Locrida. From Singapore, representing the Crocodile Foundation, Mr. and Mrs. Lee Kai Beng. Other donors and alumni from the Philippines, Mr. and Mrs. Leonardo Camagay, Mr. and Mrs. David Barona, Dr. Jimmy Lou De Castro. From the Southern Asia Pacific Division, our very own President, Pastor Leonardo Asoy, and the First Lady. Mrs. Asoy, there. From the North Philippine Union Conference, headed by the President and Chairman of AUP Board of Trustees, Pastor Neftali Manyes. And Mrs. Manyes, there. And also the Treasurer, Mr. Ravi Velasco. Thank you. And also other members of the Board of Trustees who are here. I'm seeing Dr. Tindugan. Thank you. From South Central Luzon Conference, Pastor Arnel Gabin. From Mountain Provinces Mission, Pastor Levi Payoyo. From Northern Luzon Adventist College, President Dr. Claribel Lingwasen. There at the back, thank you. From our Adventist Medical Center Presidents, Dr. Bibli Makaya of MAMSI and wife, Mrs. Lani Makaya. Doctors Abdul and Bilen Rajagukbuk. There. Dr. Hector Garyares, President of Adventist Medical Center Bacolod. There, and wife, Dr. Joy Gayares. Thank you. From the Commission on Higher Education, CHED, Region 4A, Dr. Emilu Yanga, the Director. There. And Mrs. Mary Ann Judith Chan, the Health Education Supervisor of CHED Region 4A. From the province of Cavite, Dr. George Repique, Administrator and Provincial Health Officer of General Emilio Aguinaldo Hospital, who is also representing the Honorable Governor John Vic Remulla. From the Municipality of Silang, Director Rodrigo Vivencio, Education Consultant, representing the Honorable Mayor Omil Poblete. From Barangay Puting Kahoy, Punong Barangay Petronilo Pulido. There and his kagawads. Our kagawad from Puting Kahoy, thank you. Representatives from our base hospital, Batangas Medical Center, headed by Dr. Ramoncito Magnaye, the Medical Center Chief, too. My fellow administrators, members of the faculty and staff of AUP, including the team of Dr. Doris Mendoza, the pioneer faculty of the College of Medicine. May we request you to please stand. Thank you. Thank you. And former faculty, Dr. Everett Witzel. There. Our retirees who have come. Parents. The parents of the inaugural class, may we request you to please stand. Our singers, our instrumentalists, the inaugural batch of the Doctor of Medicine program. Please stand. Thank you. Ladies and gentlemen, warmest and sincerest greetings to a program that has been in the making for decades. This indeed is the day the Lord has made. Today marks a special place in the colorful history of the Adventist University of the Philippines as the long-awaited Doctor of Medicine program is finally and officially here. Offering the Doctor of Medicine program was once a dream, and today is a sweet reality. It was once a vision, now an inspiring realization. The dream of offering the Doctor of Medicine has been a long-time vision of our earlier leaders and administrators, as health ministry is of vital importance in the proclamation of God's word. The road to this very day has been full of challenges, disappointments, and doubts. It was not an easy route. It was never a walk in the park. But with God's continuous guidance, this day has come. And we are very pleased and blessed to be part of it. We rejoice in it. We celebrate it. And we praise God for it. So let us make AUP my school, your school, our school, a breeding ground for the best physician missionaries who will help bring the everlasting to the world. Ladies and gentlemen, once again, welcome to the inauguration of the AUP College of Medicine and White Coat Ceremony. On ever onward, dear AUP, mabuhay ang College of Medicine.
Let us now welcome Dr. Francisco Gayuba for the history of the College of Medicine of the Adventist University of the Philippines.
Honored guests, friends, students, especially our faculty, I would like to say welcome. On the other hand, beyond the welcome, I feel like adding a few words like welcome to the excitement or welcome to the warmth. Welcome to a time when people reflect and rejoice on how our journey had taken place the past few years. My task this morning is to share with you the story, and we have entitled it A Journey of Faith. A journey of faith. And it is a pleasure for me to welcome all of you, because in many ways all of you had been a part of this journey. When I greeted you this morning, I remember the times we sat down, visited your offices, worked with you with the different levels. I see some of your pictures. Dr. Mendoza was showing to me the training of the faculty. All of you are part of this journey. Many of you have come from far places, traveled hours. One of our speakers arrived early morning yesterday, traveling many, many hours across the ocean. And it's indeed wonderful for all of you, all of us, to be here. A journey of faith. It is a journey of faith because this college, this program, was initiated and is hosted by a faith-based educational institution. The Adventist University of the Philippines is owned and operated by the Seventh-day Adventist Church. As such, its institutional mission is set, its story, its journey is set within the framework of the enduring values of the Seventh-day Adventist Church. In our statement of our enduring values and commitments, the Church defined our method for fulfilling our work. It states, guided by such understanding of mission that Dr. Miriam alluded to, Adventists, guided by the Bible and the Holy Spirit, the Seventh-day Adventists pursue this mission through Christ-like living, communicating, discipling, teaching, healing, and serving. The story of making this College of Medicine start is couched or enclosed or encapsulated within that understanding of what is our method or what is our place in this world. Guided by such understanding of mission, Adventists for more than a century built simple churches because their money is not only in the building of their churches, but they put their money and effort in schools such as AUP. In medical work, such as Adventist Medical Center, Manila. In clinics, in health expos, in advocacies that seek to implement the vision of healing and serving. Serving the community in disaster relief and development. That is where the Church put its money. And as I mentioned, healing and serving is essential to that understanding of what method the denomination is to use. In the Philippines, we have several Adventist medical institutions. In Bacolod, the president is here, Calbayog, Cebu, Davao, Hinoog, Iligan, Manila, Puerto Princesa, Santiago, and Valencia. In Southeast Asia, we have 4 hospitals in Indonesia, 2 in Thailand, 1 each in Malaysia, Pakistan, and Sri Lanka. And in addition to these institutions, honored guests and friends, Filipino Adventist physicians serve all over the world as missionaries. In view of this background, the story, the dream, the push, the initiative to have our own medical training school arose. Because for many years, we wanted to have a medical education that is consistent with the values of the Church, which involves the following in greater detail. The denomination has defined what is the role of Adventist medical institutions and training institutions in the Church and for the community as well. Number one is Christ-like healing. I quote, affirming the biblical principles of the well-being of the whole person. We make healthful living and healing of the sick a priority, and through our ministry to the poor and oppressed, cooperate with the Creator in His compassionate work of restoration. In addition to Christ-like healing, we also believe in Christ-like serving. I quote, following the example of Jesus, we commit ourselves to humble service, ministering to individuals and populations most affected by poverty, tragedy, hopelessness, and disease. That, my friends, is the background, if not the main element, and the theme that the story that we are recounting this morning began, continued to be nurtured and fed, and will sustain our vision in the next few years. Many of you here are not Seventh-day Adventists, but I believe you share that faith of healing and service. And we are so happy that to work with you, that the Holy Spirit, we believe, has guided you to be part of this vision. Indeed, as the motto of the AUP College of Medicine states, through Christ, healing and wholeness. That is the motto of this College of Medicine. To produce missionary physicians, not just to serve in the denominational institutions, no, but to serve wherever you will be placed and planted by the Lord, so that your practice of medicine will be in the spirit of Christ, the Master Healer. The nexus of promoting well-being and healthful living and serving with a missionary spirit is an urgent need in Philippine society more than ever. In 2013, the Department of Health launched Pilipinas Go for Health, a movement that was conceptualized to help prevent and control the prevalence of non-communicable diseases in the country, like cardiovascular diseases, cancer, diabetes, and chronic obstructive pulmonary disorder. These non-communicable diseases account for more than 70% of deaths among Filipinos, with cardiovascular as the leading killer. Around 30 to 32% of non-communicable diseases involve people who are below 60 years old. Why am I mentioning this? I am mentioning this because this context is part of the story of this college. We are here to address these issues. I am so happy that when I met several times in the context of this appointment, you know, we were rejected 2 times by the Technical Committee on Medical Education. But when I heard their vision, Dr. Rojas and the team, of what they want physicians to be, it is precisely what we believe, that we want them not only to be specialists, that will come later, but the most important thing is that we should be there to serve the community in the context of the challenges that the Philippines is facing. We were excited. We said, and they tell us, improve your curriculum, focus it there. We accepted the challenge. And the rejection had meaning for us because we believe that those are the areas also that we want to serve as a college of medicine. We fitted in the context. Yes, even now, there's a thrust in the Seventh-day Adventist Church that in our part of the world, that every local church, every church member are to be promoters of a healthy lifestyle, so that we can respond to non-communicable diseases. We want this school to be an expert, to lead out, to respond to those challenges, my dear friends. So, the story of the founding of this college. Thank you. So, the story of the founding of this college is a story of faith. It is a story of faith because it reflects the faith of those who will teach you, these people here. We believe our leaders have recruited faculty who believe that the purpose of life is to serve others. This is your story. That medicine could be a way of earning money, because the more money you have, the more you can give. But more than anything else, medicine is a profession of service. It is a story of faith because you, all of us, began this project trusting that though we do not have the money and the people when we began, God will provide. And God provided you. You are here this morning because you are testimonies of answers to our prayer. SSD, Crocodile Foundation, you just don't know how much we prayed. We believe that more than other methods of fundraising, prayer is the most important tool. So we know, sir, when you were meeting and we prayed. We know when this person, we sent out the letters, we prayed. We prayed for Dr. Mendoza, Dr. Carbajal, the rest of the department heads. They were telling us, somebody came to the office, volunteered to teach because they believe in what we wanted to do. We prayed. You are answers to our prayers because God had sent you. Thank you so much for being part of this story. We prayed too for you students. Are you aware that the Lord will send us a good first batch, 3 batches? Because you are the beginning of the DNA of the missionary spirit. How many strands are you now? The DNA coming from your mentors transferred to you will be replicated in the years to come. May you be faithful to that vision, to that story. We did not have the money to construct this building and procure the equipment. Our finance people, I think, they had more falling hairs because they keep on scratching and scratching their head. But we move forward. You are all here, God's instruments, and we thank you to be part of our history. The people in the administration, Dr. Mendoza, Dr. Carbajal, Dr. Didi, Dr. Tamano, all of you, Dr. Santa Lucia, Dr. The Batangas Medical Center too, Dr. Magnaye, Dr. Ripike, Dr. We prayed for all of those because those were the challenges. We have a list, check. Then when there's a block, we pray again. Thank you so much for making all of this possible. And all of you faculty who come from Manila, we prayed for you because we were aware that we were starting a medical school up on the hills and many of the faculty will travel. Would they come and make the sacrifices? Because our honorarium is not remuneration enough for the time and effort. Your decision to come and help us is a statement of faith too. Yes, it is a story of faith. And we believe that God will see this project through. That had been the resolve. We have here the university board, the chair, Pastor Manyes. He's part of that story. The university constituency, many of you who are here. We also want to say that the CHED is part of that story. Dr. Yanga, thank you so much for the encouragement. Thank you so much. And Ma'am Judith, you were there when we were crying, and Dr. Mendoza was, you were there all along. Thank you so much. You are part of that story. CHED supported us. They helped us go to the right offices. Dr. Yanga accompanied us and introduced us to people. Without that, our faith could have wavered. I don't know whether it would have died out, but it was such a providential leading for us. Because in the first prognosis was it's not possible for us to start the program. And so our partners are here today with us. Batangas Medical Center, Dr. Magnaye, thank you. The Provincial Health Office, General Emilio Aguinaldo Memorial Hospital, Dr. Repique, thank you. And Adventist Medical Center, Manila, thank you. Yes, you are part of the story of faith. And the story of faith continues. Tomorrow morning at 7, what time? 8 o'clock, another phase of the story will begin. It will take years to see what the results will be. But today, in the formal planting and inauguration of the store of that program, the story of faith continues. This university will have to make major decisions because we are not here for the money. The university will be subsidizing the operations of this missionary school for the next decade. Dr. Borromeo will give you the figures later. But then, we should never forget that this is our story, that we want to start a medical school that will be a center for medical missionary training. Thank you so much for being part of this story. May God bless you.
Let us now welcome Pastor Leonardo Azoy, the President of the Southern Asia Pacific Division, for the felicitation on behalf of SSD.
Good morning, everyone. As I look at this group this morning, I think the leadership of the university has invited a lot of people from different representations. And I can see in the faces of these people, including our youth today, who are to be very important part of the history, because you will be the pioneering group that will start to enjoy the blessings that the Lord has given to AUP. Congratulations. As I see all of you, with all the people here, with their white, I should say, regalia, if it is regalia, maybe a uniform, whatever it is, I can see the kind of trainers that will lead our young people to that kind of preparation for service that is unique to this region, that we will witness and see for the first time. You know, Southern Asia Pacific Division is covering something like 14 countries in this region. And this is the only medical institution that we will operate starting tomorrow. And this is also the sixth institution that we have, Dr. Landless, around the world. It is not an ordinary thing to start that kind of endeavor. And we are happy that after more than 30 years as a vision for the church leadership in this region, now it is a reality. Praise the Lord for that. That's why this morning the leadership of NPUC is celebrating Dr. Manyes. And of course, the leadership of AUP has invited all of you. I think I can say today that we have invited all the representations from the rich and also from the poor. Why? The rich people are here, and the poor are also represented by Dr. Landless. He is poor, he is landless, you know. But he is the director of the health department at the General Conference of the Seventh-day Adventist. Congratulations, Seventh-day Adventist in this region. North Philippine Union Conference, we are happy for you. And I would like to give my commitment to this group today at the hearing of this August body that Southern Asia Pacific Division will render a support that probably you have not seen it yet, because we will involve all the unions in this division to support this medical school in this university. And when I say it is the unions of this region, of this division, that will include all the conferences, local conferences and missions, all medical institutions under our watch, all educational institutions under our care, because this is a project of the church. It is all for one and one for all, Dr. Manyes. You know, I am congratulating all of you, but the challenge is ahead of us. If we will not work together, regardless of what kind of support that we have seen through all these members of alumni associations from different places around the world, we will not succeed, you know, if we will not be united in this region. So I will promise, Dr. Yanga, that with your support also from your area, your department, we will do our best, because we know that this is the kind of institution that we will produce physicians, not just physicians, but self-sacrificing physicians that will do a pattern of ministry after that of the ministry of Jesus Christ. You know what? When one day David Livingstone, he was home, you know, from Africa, And he was addressing a crowd, a group of Edinburgh people in Scotland. And he was saying, God had only one son to give to the world. And he sent him not only as a missionary, but also as a medical worker. You like that, Dr. Landless, right? In other words, the Father in heaven did not only send a pastor, but he sent a medical doctor as a missionary to the world. That's why in that premise, brothers and sisters, in that premise, fellow workers, in that background, fellow workers, the objective, the purpose of really supporting this vision for 30 years, because we want to produce people who are doing a kind of ministry that is patterned after the ministry of Jesus Christ. His ministry is what? A ministry with a self-sacrificing spirit. That's the pattern. And our passion is the passion of Jesus to save souls. And that passion is added, to say it this way, to save sin-sick souls. I'm happy to share that to you this morning, that in one of the statements that I'd like to share, you know, to all people, when we are talking about medical ministry, we are told in the book that I have been reading, Medical Ministry 248, you know, physicians should reveal the higher education in this ability, in his ability, to point to the Savior of the world as one who can heal and save the soul and the body. The ministry of the physical and the spiritual are to blend together, leading the afflicted ones to trust in the power of the heavenly physician. That's Jesus Christ, right? You know, this dream, this vision for the church in this region has been there for, I think, to be close to what is exact, is something like 32, 33 years already, Dr. Manyes. And at that time, we were interned with Dr. Gayuba, because we graduated the same year in college. And also we graduated the same year in our masteral in IAS at last time. We had been waiting for this, you know. We had been included in a group of people who were praying for the reality of this vision. But it did not happen that early, probably something like 10 years ago or 15 years ago. But after more than 33 years, we have this today. And did you know that we had been waiting for this, all those people in our age, at our age? The son of Dr. Manyes with my son graduated from the medical school 2 months ago. It was in Southwestern University in the Visayas, because we had been waiting for our own school that has the kind of training that we had been expecting for our young people, but it did not come at that time until when they graduated 2 months ago, we heard that AUP will open this coming Monday. How will you say that? How I wish I have another son. I have a daughter who is working as a nurse in Iligan, and I tried to challenge that if she wants to start, then she can start. And she said, maybe it's too late for me. I will proceed as a nurse. It is enough for my elder brother to be a physician, with the blessings of God, of course. But today, it's a day of celebration for all of us. It's a day to thank the Lord. It's a day to give praises unto our Father in heaven. Because if you will read Ecclesiastes 9, verse 1, all of his people who are wise, all of his people who are with wisdom and righteous, who are doing the leadership of the church, God is holding them in his hand. Say amen to that. God is holding AOP in his hands, you know. And it's a good reminder that as servants of the Lord has put his spirit upon each one of us, that we will do what is a delight to him, so that all of us in the leadership responsibilities of the institution, we will give justice to the gospel and to the nation. Having this kind of institution right here is not only that we will produce physicians, but we will produce physicians who will do their ministry patterned after that of Jesus Christ, who has the passion to save souls, who has the priority to save sin sick souls. Mabuhay ang AOP, mabuhay ang medical school. The blessings of the Lord be upon all of us. Good morning. Thank you, everyone.
Let us have the representative from the governor of the province of Cavite. Let us give a round of applause to our beloved doctor.
Good morning. I am Dr. George Repique. I'm the provincial health officer of the province of Cavite. On behalf of our beloved governor, Juanito Victor Sirimulya Jr., he wants to extend his congratulations to the Adventist University of the Philippines College of Medicine. To the first year students, I would like to challenge you, being the PHO of the province of Cavite. You know the population of the province of Cavite is growing. As of 2015, June, we're reaching 4.5 million Caviteños. The vision of the governor is Cavite first class, world class. One of the dreams, one of the mission is the 617 challenge. What is 617? The vision, the governor estimated that the population of the province of Cavite will reach 6 million by the year 2017. We are a very small in land area. We have 7 congressional districts. We have 5 interlocal health zones. Interlocal health zone means the different municipalities unite, like Roscanovka, Rosario, Noveleta, Cavite, and Cavite City. They unite to become an interlocal health zone. So for this school, it's located in Silang. It belongs to the 5th district, Carsigma, Carmona, Silang, and GMA. Majority of these populace are not well off. So we'll be reaching 6 million by the year 2017. So we have to provide adequate education, healthcare, housing for our fellow Caviteños. That's why the governor, his vision for the 617 challenge is for the province to be prepared for any eventualities. We have 589 barangay health stations, 861 barangays, we have 35 rural health units, we have 52 hospitals in the whole province, but 42 of which are privately owned hospitals. Only 10 are government hospitals. So that the rural health physician to population ratio of the province of Cavite is 1:53,675. The standard ratio for a rural health physician to population ratio is 1:20,000 population. So my challenge to you young doctors, if you haven't, I think you haven't chosen your specialty, why not go to public health and join us in the government service so that you can be an answer to our lacking of a doctor to population ratio. So we'll be reaching 6 million by the time you graduate. So I hope welcome to the provincial health office. And I would like to congratulate the faculty. Thank you for giving your time to these children, to these young folks, to these youth leaders. I was a youth leader, but due to fate, I am now a provincial health officer at my young age. I bore the great problems of the province of Cavite. We have the highest HIV cases in Calabarzon, human immunodeficiency. We have the highest in multiple drug-resistant tuberculosis in Calabarzon. We're number 3 in the national area. We have an increasing number of rabies cases in the province. Dengue is controllable in the province. We are a malaria-free province. For the past 8 years, we are malaria-free. The province of Cavite is malaria, so you don't have to worry about malaria. We are malaria-free province. So I hope this shield, in answer to the Kalusugang Pangkalahatan by the Aquino Health Agenda, President Aquino will leave his office by next year, by June. And we have to attain the Millennium Development Goals, of which the province of Cavite haven't reached the maternal mortality ratio. In fact, in 2013, instead of going down 162, we became 222 per 100,000 live births for the maternal mortality. For the province of Cavite alone, we have 89 maternal deaths for the 2013. In 2014, we have 51 maternal deaths. It's because of so many lying-ins in the province, of the midwives, late referral of midwives to our health facility. That's why majority of mothers are dying of postpartum hemorrhage because of the late referral to our health facilities. So I hope this will not depress your mood for entering the College of Medicine. I'm just stating the realities. I've been in public service for 14 years since I graduated from the University of the Philippines and graduated my residency in general surgery at the Philippine General Hospital. I became a faculty of the Genelta School of Medicine. I attended the conferences in Adventist Medical Center. You know, when you were fresh from residency, you don't have money, you cannot have stocks. So I was a wandering Jew in the different hospitals in Metro Manila, and then Dr. Alday adopted me in Perpetual, and then I came the government, and now I'm now here. And I'm speaking to the government because I think I can make a difference to the province of Cavite. Congratulations to the Adventist University of the Philippines. Mabuhay po tayong lahat. Thank you.
Thank you very much. For our next felicitation, let us welcome the representative of the mayor of the municipality of Silang Cavite, Philippines.
Magandang umaga, mga piling panauhin, mga namamahala ng paaralang ito, mga guro, mga mag-aaral, mga ginang, mga ginoo, at mga binibining nandito. Magandang umaga ulit sa inyo. Pasensya na po kayo, hindi makakarating ating punong bayan Emilia Lourdes Poblete, sapagkat kahapon pa po nasa Maynila siya, sa mga pagpupulong tungo sa ikaunlad ng ating bayan ng Silang. Whenever someone asks me, saan ka nakatira? I say, I come from Silang. Ang isasagot sa akin, sa AUP. Whenever someone asks about AUP, sa Silang yan. Silang and AUP has become synonymous to each other. This great institution of learning, the Adventist University of the Philippines, has become not only a spot, a period in the map of the town of Silang, Cavite. It has become a great institution of learning whose graduates have been in business and industry doing their mettle towards progress of our country. Silang is replete with historic events. And tomorrow, history will again be written in the annals of history of our great town of Silang when this first batch of medical students start their studies in the fields of medicine. Let us give these children A great big hand of applause. Ang AUP po, kilalang kilala na sa buong Pilipinas at ang silang nangyayari din po yun. Magbabalik tanaw po ako 1954 when my mother was operated goiter operation. The procedure was made by a certain American doctor, Richley. Saan po? Sa Manila Sanitarium. Ngayon ay Manila Adventist Medical Center. Kaya po, kay Lolo Tochi po, napakalapit ng mga Adventist. Sapagkat po, isinalba ni Dr. Richley ang buhay ng aking ina noong siya ay operahan sa goiter. Palakpakan po natin si Dr. Richley kung buhay pa siya. Palakpakan din natin ang Manila Sanitarium. Palakpakan din natin po ang Adventist, mga Adventist. Minsan po tinanong si Dr. Charles Eliot, eminent and active head of Harvard University. Tinanong siya, bakit ang Harvard ang tinatawag na storehouse ng knowledge ng Amerika? Very humble po si Dr. Charles Eliot. Hindi ko masiguro, pero ang nasisiguro ko, yung mga pressman, kamuha ninyo, ay maraming dinadalang kaalaman sa Harvard. Totoo ba yun? Marami daw dinadalang kaalaman ang mga pressman ng Harvard. Paniwala ko rin sa umagang ito, itong pulutong ng mga itong mga mag-aaral ay maraming dadaling kaalaman sa paaralang AUP at ganoon din naman ang mga faculty ng AUP na bibigyan nyo sila ng kaalaman upang sila'y maging doktor sa darating na mga panahon. Kanina kausap ko si Dr. Olarte ng PMA. Nasaan siya? Tinanong ko kung ano mga paaralang nandito sa Batangas about medicine. Wala daw po. Dito sa Cavite, isa lamang nandun sa Dasma. Sa Laguna, mayroong isa sa Binyang. Ibig sabihin, may parting norte. Kamukha ng UMC Dasma. Kung ganoon, ang mga mag-aaral, mahihilig maging doktor nang gagaling dito sa Cavite, south of UMC, sa Batangas, sa Laguna, south of Binyang, dito mag-aaral sa AUP. Pagkat kilala ang paaralang ito, oo nga, for the first time sa medisina, kilala sa iba't ibang kurso ng linya ng pag-aaral. Saan ka pa? Sa AUP ka na. Pwede nyo ba akong samahan? Sabay-sabay tayo. Saan ka pa? Sa AUP. Sa AUP ka na. Napakasarap magsalita sa ganitong kongregasyon ng mga matatalino from the academy and from the students. Ngayon po, pagpasehin sa inyo na lamang at ako ay meron pang apat na pupuntahan. Meron po sa Bulihan, disaster yung pagtuturo about Lindol. Alam niyo naman ang Lindol ngayon. At meron din nga pala, mabanggit ko sa AUP, meron po si Mayor Omil na clean up drive. Magsasalita din po ako doon sa Biluso. At meron din po sa ulat tungkol naman sa drug abuse. Pabiyang hapon, yung pwedeng hindi napuntahan yun, yung bang, yung karera ng motocross, yung ano ba tawag doon, yung mga ganyan, mga sasakyan. Pero with the indulgence of the leadership of the school, pwede ba akong magbigay ng some pick-up line sa mga estudyante? Kukuha ka ba ng medicine? Ako, matagal nang kumuha ng medicine. Kaya nga lamang sa medicine cabinet. Magandang umaga po. Maraming salamat sa inyo lahat.
Thank you very much. For our next felicitation, let us welcome the director of CHED Region 4A, Dr. Emilu B. Yanga. Let us give a big hand to the CHED director, Region 4A.
To our honored guests, officials, teaching and non-teaching staff of this university, students, I would like to have a special mention to the faculty of the College of Medicine. Palakpakan po natin sila. Ladies and gentlemen, good morning. Magandang umaga po sa atin lahat. I believe that I can truly say that today is a day of rejoicing. Agree? Thank God and praise the Lord. This is a great day for the officials and members of the academic community of Adventist University of the Philippines. Today will forever be etched on your university's history because of a major milestone which you have recently achieved. That is why I feel honored and privileged to be a witness today of your university's milestone. In behalf of the Commission on Higher Education, I take pride to convey my heartfelt and warmest congratulations again to the officials and members of the academic community of Adventist University of the Philippines and to all those who have been waiting for this day to come. On this inauguration and dedication of your College of Medicine, and of course, to officially open the College of Medicine program. Congratulations again. I am fully aware that this is not an easy feat to operate a College of Medicine, considering the huge necessary physical, financial, as well as manpower requirements. This feat is all the more made challenging by the demand of the hospital industry to produce globally competent, but not only globally competent, but spiritually equipped medical doctors. Hence, I can truly say that the challenges ahead of you are indeed overwhelming and insurmountable. Thus, when I learned about the inauguration of this new building, the College of Medicine, I felt happy and relieved, knowing that you will now be able to better address the educational needs of your students in fully equipping them for the task and responsibilities ahead of them. I personally believe that with the university's officials' proactive and transformational leadership, your university will certainly be steered in the direction that is geared towards the attainment of its mission and vision. This building is a testament of the university's relentless effort to deliver quality medical education which is within the reach of all Philippine people regardless of their socio-economic status in life. This building is a concrete manifestation of the management's response to the needs of the student populace and the community as well. Over the past years, Adventist University of the Philippines has consistently and steadfastly blazed new trails by introducing innovative developments, endeavors in higher education, which has served as touchstone and lamppost of other institutions, not only in Cavite Province, but also in the entire region. And for your information, this is one of the autonomous universities that CHED has accredited. I hope that you'll continue to blaze new trails and that you'll continue to explore uncharted courses. May God continue to crown your hard work and efforts with abundant blessings so you may continue ministering to others through education. Once again, congratulations on this major milestone. To God be the glory.
Thank you very much, Dr. Yanga. Now, let us listen to a special song from the AUP ambassadors, Mr. Dante Oblimar conducting. Round of applause to our ambassadors. For the introduction of the speaker, Pastor Hotman Sinaga, the director of the Adventist Chaplaincy Department, will introduce to us our guest speaker for the inauguration message.
It is a privilege and honor for me to introduce our speaker this morning. Our speaker is the Director of Education at the General Conference of the Seventh-day Adventist World Headquarters, where she oversees the work of education worldwide. She was born in England and completed 2 years of theology at Newburgh College, England. She then studied on what today is the campus of the Adventist University of the Philippines, and also lived in the Women's Residence Hall on the Bayasa campus of Philippine Union College during the Metro Manila Crusade for a course of an evangelism. If I ask her, saan kana, she will answer, sa AUP, because she was alumnus of Adventist University of the Philippines. We are very proud of her. She graduated with a Bachelor of Theology from the Seventh-day Adventist Theological Seminary, Far East, now Adventist International Institute of Advanced Studies. She earned an MPH from Loma Linda University, a PhD in Educational Psychology from the University of Hawaii, and an MBA from Claremont Graduate University, California. Her clinical pastoral education was at the Methodist Medical Center of Illinois, and she held ecclesiastical endorsement as an associate chaplain in healthcare from the North American Division of Seventh-day Adventists. She also provided spiritual care as a healthcare chaplain at Lakeland Medical Center, Michigan. Our speaker has been an educator since 1980, having taught at primary, secondary, and tertiary levels in public and private schools in Finland and the United States. She has served on nearly 100 accreditation visits, and she is an honorary auditor with the Tertiary Education Quality and Standard Agency for the Australian Government, served as a commissioner for the Western Association of Schools and Colleges Accrediting Commission for Senior Colleges and Universities in the United States. She currently chairs the board of the Adventist Accrediting Association. She holds citizenship in 3 countries, United Kingdom, USA, and Finland. But there's another one, another citizenship. Heavenly citizen. She enjoys cross-country skiing, rollerblading, and collecting mushrooms. She is married to Dr. Frank Wilton Hardy, who is with her now. Their daughter is married to a Seventh-day Adventist pastor, and they have 2 grandchildren. It is an honor for me to introduce our inauguration speaker, Dr. Lisa Bresley Hardy. Okay, thank you very much.
Magandang umaga po. It's good to be back home again. The Seventh-day Adventist system of education has over 8,000 schools around the world. And we employ about 92,000 teachers. I'm glad to see some of our teachers here. And we enroll 1.87 million students. Of those institutions, 113 are universities and colleges. Of that number, we have only 5 medical schools. And today, we will add a 6th medical school. Congratulations. It was in 1979, 1980, when I was taking a class in maternal and child health at what was then PUC, Philippine Union College, and that required me to do some rotations at Manila Sanitarium. I had to be with the surgeons as they were doing various procedures The very first procedure that I was to observe was of a woman who had severe endometriosis. She had been suffering for many years, and the surgeons decided that the only way to care for her was to do a hysterectomy. I was excited about seeing my first surgery, going in, scrubbing, and doing everything, and watching as each layer of the abdomen was opened, and finally seeing the abdomen open, glistening and clean. And the surgery was going well. The surgeon was explaining to me everything that he was doing. And all of a sudden, I noticed the skin at either end of her abdomen, up near the sternum, almost down near the pubic bone, and it hit me that I was looking inside of a living human being that was open, and this was not natural. When I started thinking about it, I started to feel a little queasy. My legs started to feel a little weak, and I was standing there, and I was afraid I was going to faint straight down into the open abdomen. I couldn't hold the table. I would then contaminate the surgical field, so the only thing I thought to do was go to the end of the table where there was a stool, and I sat down on the stool and kind of steadied myself. Well, the surgeon was very focused on what he was doing, and he kept on talking, didn't notice what I had done, that I was sitting down at the edge of the patient's feet, and by this time he had removed the uterus. He walked over to me and he said, "Look." I looked at it and it was shiny, a little bit of blood, and it had some misformed shapes on the surface. He took his scalpel and he punctured one of those misshapen blotches, and he said, "These are called chocolate cysts." And as he punctured it, this brown, what looked like melted chocolate was oozing out. Some of the surgeons are laughing over here. This melted chocolate oozed out into the dish, and it was interesting to me and grotesque all at the same time. This was my introduction to surgery. You medical students are going to have some experiences like that. A very sacred privilege is yours to be a physician, to be invited into the most intimate parts of a person's life, a sacred space for healing. I remember another procedure. This time I was in pre-surgery with the anesthesiologist. It was a young wife who had just miscarried. She and her husband were so happy waiting for their first child, and she had miscarried this child. The bleeding didn't stop, so the physician determined that she needed to have a DNC, a dilation and curettage. So they took her in. She had already lost too much blood. She was very frightened. She was in grief having lost this child. And the anesthesiologist at this time became Christ to her. Before they wheeled her in, he said to her, "Would you like for me to pray with you?" She had oxygen and she nodded, yes. Her big eyes were filled with fear, brown eyes. And he prayed for her and he prayed that God would bring healing, that he would be close to her. I closed my eyes during that prayer as well. When I opened that, her eyes were filled with peace. All of that fear was gone. She closed her eyes and they wheeled her into surgery. Well, after a long day at Manila Sanitarium, I was living here on this campus, the Silang campus at the time. I would have to take a bus then to Santa Rosa, from Santa Rosa, catch a jeepney to Balibago, from Balibago. You wait until the jeepney would be full, and late at night, you could wait a long time. They wouldn't leave if one person was in the jeepney. They would wait. This is going up to Tagaytay. So I waited a long time, and if you went by either bus or jeepney, you would get off over here by Puting Kahoy. It was a little barrio, only had a few nipa huts at that time. If you had a private car, you could take a shortcut through the sugarcane field. Well, I was a student, I didn't have a car, and a few times I had gone through the sugarcane fields with somebody else, but for a student, it was the bus, it was the jeepney, it was a second jeepney, and then being dropped off out here by Puting Kahoy, walking across what then was a pineapple, had upland rice, pineapple, and coffee. And the coffee in the spring smelled so nice, those white blossoms, wonderful smell. Well, one night, the traffic was especially bad in Manila. The roads were potholed, and I had to wait a long time in Balibago for the jeepney to fill. Finally, by the time I got dropped off here, it was pitch black. I could not see anything. There were no street lights. This was in, well, about more than 35 years ago. No street lights at all. I didn't have a flashlight. Even the village was quiet at that time. The villagers were afraid of the wok-woks. You know what the wok-woks are? Some of the visitors don't know. This is a half-human, half-bird vampire-like witch that flies, and it's looking for human prey to eat the heart. So at night, the wok-wok would keep all the people inside. Well, I wasn't afraid of the wok-woks. But it was dark, and so I had to walk like this with my hands in front of me because I was afraid I was going to hit it, run into a tree. I just couldn't see anything. It was just a footpath, a dirt path, no paving then. And the only way I knew that I was off the path, I was wearing a dress about this length, was that the grass would brush up against my legs. And then I knew, okay, I'm off the path. I have to get back on until I could feel nothing brushing up against my legs again. Walking across there, it's where the gate is today. At that time, there was no church, and you had to walk down the path. It was very eroded going down to the river there. Then you had to cross the river and then go back up the other side to where the bridge is. It's easy today. You go in the car, it just takes you a few minutes. But when you're doing this at night in the dark, it's really difficult. And it was hard for me going down and then scrambling back up the other side in the dark, walking like this, trying to keep my balance. Well, as I said, I wasn't afraid of the dark. I wasn't afraid of the walk-walk. But I was afraid that there might be a person lurking somewhere in those behind the bananas, especially when you get down by the river, a lot of banana trees down there and big grasses. I was afraid somebody might be in there, so I walked as fast as I could. When I came up the hill by the river here, near where the guard station is over here, or the dental office, I came to the gravel road. It was only one road, this road, but it was a gravel road, went down by the motor pool. And when I got to the road, all of a sudden, it was beautiful. The moon came out. There was a silvery light. I could see walking all the way back up the road. The dream of a medical school here in the SSD, it's 35 years old, we learned from Dr. Witzel. It goes back to Dr. Richley. It's actually 70 years old. This dream is 70 years old, and it has been a slow and circuitous process. At one time, there were plans to have it in Mindanao. That was the last. And then those plans faltered. In the past few years, the lack of an acceptable teaching hospital seemed to be an insurmountable obstacle. We had thought perhaps we could do it in Manila, but Manila had too many hospitals. And then Manila Adventist Medical Center didn't have enough patients, many private patients, but not enough public patients. So another obstacle we thought we couldn't get past. Times we were working, we would get reports about working with CHED, another obstacle that needed to be met. And thank you, by the way, for the work of the technical panel. We in the Adventist Accrediting Association greatly value the work of the national accrediting agencies and the professional accrediting agencies because you're more in touch with the local expectations and needs. So thank you. We have not faulted you at all. We are glad that we're working. We consider ourselves to be working with you as you articulate what the expectations are. But we would hear, okay, there's another expectation, this has to be done. So it was going, again, to the side. At times, it seemed like we were walking in the dark with our hands out before us, trying to feel if there's anything else that we might be bumping into. And at times, it was only the softest touch that made us know we're still on the right track. We need to go this way. Nevertheless, the Lord has been with us every step of the way, whether we saw him there or not. He has been with us. He touched Dr. Doris Mendoza, an experienced medical educator, with his healing
power. During her convalescence from a stroke, from uterine cancer, from breast cancer, through a lengthy period of rehabilitation, he introduced her to the legacy of book, and introduced her to Loma Linda University, where she ended up doing a rotation at Loma Linda University Medical Center already in 2007, and she came back here. He then arranged for her to return back here, and she in time became a member of the Seventh-day Adventist Church. It was in 2011 when I heard from Dr. Gayoba, "We think we have a founding dean." Well, I had heard this before. This is not the only country in the world that wants a medical school, and so I've heard this before. So I said, I want to see this person. And so she came, and I could see she was a real person. That was a good start. Sometimes when the country tells me they want to do things and I see a CV, but then a person doesn't materialize with the CV, or that person is living in the US or some in Europe, they're really not available. She came, I talked with her, and I heard her story, and I said, "Dr. Mendoza, you are like Queen Esther. You have been called for such a time as this. I was convicted that this was the Lord's leading, and that you were called for such a time as this." But it is not just Dr. Mendoza who has been called for such a time as this. He called you, Dr. Landless, to be Director of Health Ministries for the worldwide work of the Seventh-day Adventist Church for such a time as this, with your extensive international experience in medicine, cardiology, in medical education. And he called you for such a time as this. He called me, who had spent time, 2 years I lived here on this campus, and I have a genuine affection for the Philippines and for this institution. He called me to be director of the Seventh-day Adventist work of education. I'm the first woman in the history of the Seventh-day Adventist Church to be a director of education. He called me for such a time as this. Dr. Landless and I were just talking about this, that in the history of the Seventh-day Adventist Church, until 2011, we had only 3 medical schools. In 2011 and 12, we added 2 more, one in Nigeria, one in Peru. This will be number 6. It has been a wonderful working relationship with the Department of Health Ministries. And Dr. Landless, I'd like to thank you and your colleagues. We could have not done this without your support. I truly prize the relationship that we have with the Department of Health Ministries and all of the hospitals that they oversee around the world. This is a partnership. And the Lord has called you faculty, each one of you, for such a time as this. The experiences you bring, your expertise, your passion to make a difference, and you will make a difference, but he has called you for such a time as this. God bless you, each one. And he has called the alumni, Dr. Bangloy, Dr. Quintes, the others that are representing, he has called you and the well-wishers for such a time as this. God bless you. And you pioneers, you students who are the pioneering class of the AUP College of Medicine, he has called each one of you for such a time as this. What will you do when you graduate? Will you be medical missionaries for these last days? Will you take this work forward? Today, we stand in the silvery light of the road that stretches before us, and we can see now more than one step ahead of us. There will be twists and turns ahead, and you pioneer students, I ask you for your patience, because there will be mistakes that are made when something is done for the first time. But keep in mind that you are pioneers and you are blazing the way. And 35 years from now, you'll be looking back and you'll say, "I was part of that pioneering class." And you'll have stories to tell, like the one I had walking through the dark, you'll have many more stories to tell as this pioneering class. There will be choices to make. In administration, there'll be choices to make. Dr. Mendoza, there'll be choices to make. Do we turn to the right? Do we turn to the left? Do we go straight? Do we stop and wait for the Lord's leading? There are many decisions ahead yet. Our first medical school is not Loma Linda University. Our first medical school was the American Medical Missionary College. It started in 1878 at Battle Creek Sanitarium. In 1895, the state of Illinois gave it a charter. It was named the American Medical Missionary College. Students received their education at Battle Creek Sanitarium and also in Chicago, where they did a great work reaching out to the poor, to prostitutes. They had a wonderful rehabilitation program to enable prostitutes, for example, to develop skills so that they could earn an honest living. They did a wonderful work of social reform. For a period of time, Dr. John Harvey Kellogg, he was the director. He was also the director of education. He held my position at the General Conference. James and Ellen White had encouraged Dr. John Harvey Kellogg, well, first, not doctor then, but John Harvey Kellogg, to pursue a career in medicine and helped him when he went to the School of Medicine at the University of Michigan. Ellen White became deeply distressed when, around the time of the medical school, AMMC, American Medical Missionary College, she began to see that he was on a trajectory that was leading him away from the church. She pled with him. She wept. She wrote many letters. She wrote admonitions urging him to turn his steps back forward and keep his gaze fixed on Christ. He continued to move in a direction, and so that was the time when Ellen White encouraged John Burden, a business manager, to find a place that was shown to her in vision where both education and healthcare took place. From 1895 to 1905, John Burden found this place. Today, that is Loma Linda University. 1905, they started the nursing program. 1909, they started medicine. From 1909 to 1910, for 1 year, the church had two medical schools, the American Medical Missionary College and what was then called the College of Medical Evangelists, CME. In 1910, because Dr. John Harvey Kellogg said this, his school must be non-sectarian, must be open to all, it should graduate medical missionaries, but in a non-sectarian fashion, it became part of Illinois State University. It merged, and our first medical school was lost to the denomination forever. So Loma Linda, our flagship, is actually our second medical school. 1973 was the next medical school, Montemorelos University. For that span of time, we had only one medical school after AMMC was lost. Nothing is left of AMMC except a rock. And if you come to the campus of Loma Linda University, you'll find this rock. It's about the size of this boulder. It, at the top of it has 99, and it says four words, "Let us follow him." Let us follow him. There is nothing left from that medical school. It did graduate a few outstanding physicians, such as the great China physician. That was one of the graduates. But other than that, we don't have any legacy left. If you went to Battle Creek today, and that's Dr. Harry Miller, by the way, Dr. Harry Miller, the great China physician, he graduated from AMMC. If you went to Battle Creek today, the mansion that Dr. John Harvey Kellogg built is an empty lot. There is no house there anymore. He and his wife never had children, but they adopted many foster children. It is simply an empty lot today. The huge Battle Creek Sanitarium, it was world famous. People from around the world, royalty, would come to the Battle Creek Sanitarium. It went bankrupt in the Great Depression. And today it was purchased by the federal government. If you go there today in Battle Creek, it towers over the city of Battle Creek. Still there is an imposing structure, but it is a building of the federal government for inventorying military equipment and a data center. You can't get in there without a passport or some government-issued ID. It's a restricted facility, but it's still an imposing facility. But there is no legacy left there. This great man, Dr. John Harvey Kellogg, has left behind an empty lot and unwritten pages of what might have been if he had continued to do what was on that rock to follow Christ. What will our legacy be here? This will be no ordinary medical school. There are 45 medical schools in the Philippines. The Philippines doesn't need just another medical school. This is going to be a medical school following the inspired counsel of Ellen White to create and graduate medical missionaries who will care for the whole person. And so I'd like to assure Dr. Repike, is the Dr. Repike, I would like to assure you that in our approach, we take a comprehensive approach, and that is public health. There is a strong public health program here established, and that is our philosophy, not just to treat the person, not just to treat the family, but to treat the community. And that public health approach is part of what we do. But it's also to treat the spiritual needs as well. So I here publicly give you a commitment for a public health approach. This medical school needs to start its work from Jerusalem. That is, we will first address the needs of Cavite. We are living here, we will first address those needs. But we will go beyond Cavite to the Philippines, beyond that, because this division serves 14 countries, Indonesia, all the way to Sri Lanka, to Pakistan. And of this school, may it be said that AUP's College of Medicine graduated the great Palawan physician, that he graduated the great Indonesia physician, that this school has graduated the great Pakistan physician, just like AMMC graduated the great China physician, Dr. Harry Miller. In the days and years ahead, may the legacy and the impact of the SSD School of Medicine, it's not just AUP School of Medicine, this is the SSD, the Southern Asia Pacific Division's School of Medicine, to serve, yes, starting in Cavite, but to serve the entire region and going to the world. This is to be an international class of a medical school with an international faculty. And an international student body. And I recognize that we are primarily Filipinos, but as this grows in stature, we expect this to be an international medical school reaching international standards. The words on the boulder from what was now AMMC still says today, let us follow him. Let us follow him. AMMC has ceased. The great man, Dr. John Harvey Kellogg, has left no legacy, but we have an opportunity to do it right here at the College of Medicine. If we make God first, if we follow him, this medical school will make a mark and will reach from here in Cavite, in Silang Cavite, all the way to eternity. I challenge you here to write a different history than that of AMMC. And to that end, Dr. Mendoza, I'd like you to step forward, if you would, for a minute. I would like to give you two books here for the medical school library. The first book is an illustration of Christ of the Narrow Way, and this was based on the very first vision that Ellen White had when she was a young woman. The first vision, she was wondering, where are the people of God? And the angel said, look up. And when she looked up, she could see that they were going up a narrow path on the side of a mountain, and she could see that as long as they kept their eyes on Christ, they were safe. That's the first vision. But when they took their eyes off Christ, they fell from the path. This first vision, the Christ of the Narrow Way, let us follow him, and may this be an inspiration for the School of Medicine Library. The second book is a book entitled Adventist Pioneer and Places, New York and New England. And this is an illustrated volume of the history of the Seventh-day Adventist Church so that you as leaders and teachers understand the lessons of history so that we don't repeat the mistakes of history. We can learn from those and do it right here by the grace of God. I'd like to read a charge now, and I'd like to invite you to participate, and I'm going to start with the administrators. And the response that I'm inviting you to say as administrators, including you, Dr. Gayoba, Dr. Nabarte, other administrators here, your response will be, I will. And so I'm reading you a charge. Administrators, I charge you to follow him, to read the counsels given to our early pioneers, and lead as one who has learned from our own denominational history. If this is your determination, say, I will, together with me. I will. Thank you. You may be seated. Faculty, and I invite you to stand. Faculty, I charge you to follow him. Make it your study to understand his paths so well that you can model a sacrificial, balanced life so that these students can safely follow you. If this is your determination, say, I will, together with me. I will. Thank you. You may be seated. Alumni and friends of AUP, if you consider yourself a friend of AUP, this is the time for you to stand. Alumni and friends of AUP, I charge you to follow him. Give of your time, your means, and above all, your prayers to further the mission of God. May it be said of you that they gave, and they gave cheerfully. If this is your determination, say, I will, together with me. I will. Thank you, alumni and friends of AUP. May be seated. And students, I invite you to stand. Students, medical students of the pioneer class of the Adventist University of the College of Medicine, I charge you to follow him. Give the Bible as keen study as you do anatomy, physiology, and pathology. May it be said of you, there is the great Palawan doctor. There is the great Indonesia doctor. There is the great Pakistan doctor, as you go out as medical missionaries from here to the ends of the earth. If this is your determination, say, I will, together with me. I will. Thank you. May God bless you. May the God who has heard our affirmations today enable us by his grace to carry them out. Mabuhay on College of Medicine.
Thank you very much, Dr. Lisa Bursley, for that message. Now let us go to the second part of our program this morning for the white coat ceremony. Now we're going to listen to a felicitation from Pastor Neftali Manyas, the president of the North Philippine Union Conference.
Honored guests, especially Dr. Lisa Hardy, faculty, administrators of Adventist University of the Philippines, to everyone present here, good morning. If I am to speak on words that would deal with technicalities, I'm gonna bore you. And so because of that, and because you have heard many things said in relation to the history of the College of Medicine and all that, I would probably even bore you more. So I'm going to address the students and the faculty. You know, our world today is ravaged by many, many kinds of diseases. They take lives, precious lives. They separate families. They separate people from their communities. And you, students, you will be the ones who will do maybe research in relation to the diseases that are ravaging this world. I don't know. But today, and especially tomorrow, you will begin your formal medical courses. I urge you to be very strong in what you're going to do. There is a task ahead of you, and unless you are truly committed to doing what you have to do, you're going to be a failure. And if you're going to be a failure, the school that trains you will also be in some ways a failure. Faculty who will be molding your minds, helping you learn of the ins and outs of medical jargon and medical things, it'll also be a failure on their part. No, we don't want to discuss failure. We don't want to be failures. We want to make sure that as you spend your days here at AUP, you want to make sure that you will be successful in what you are doing. And so, with this, I'd like you to think of Christ. When God created the world, this was a world that was perfect in many ways. No illness, no diseases, nothing. It was really perfect. But sin came in and destroyed what God made in the beginning. Today, we are witnesses to what Satan has been doing in relation to these diseases. I heard that you're going to be following a motto that says, through Christ. What comes next? Healing and wholeness. Make sure that you will truly become the kind of medical doctors that God wants you to be. And the faculty here, in your hands, the fate of these students hang. And I was sitting there a while ago, I was asking myself, who among these students will become top 5 in the board? Or maybe top 10 in the board? Or maybe top 17? Never in the history of our board examinations in this country has a school garnered the top 17 places. There are 17 of you students, right? That's thinking big. But we never can tell. If you will follow what your faculty wants you to follow, and if you will stick your mind to the things that you need to focus on, nothing is impossible. So, faculty members, in your hands, these students will be relying for guidance, for knowledge, for wisdom. And I pray that you will do the best that you can to make these students the kind of students God wants them to be, the kind of doctors that God wants them to be. You know, I remembered David Livingstone.